I came across a bird the other day that I took to immediately. It was a hacker's bird. Every computer addict should adopt one as a pet. It's called a megapode. And it has the perfect hacker's mentality. Now, I'll tell you where I came across it first. It lives in Indonesia, and I came across it on the island of Komodo, which is where the dragons come from. Now, let me open some parentheses here. There are going to be a lot of these. Do you know about the Komodo dragons? All right, I'll tell you about them. They're not actually dragons, of course, but they're monitor lizards. And they're thought to be the origin of the Chinese dragon myth, because they're very, very big. The biggest one alive at the moment is about 12 feet long. They're man-eaters, and they don't actually breathe fire. They do have the worst breath of any creature known to man. To open some more parentheses, I'll tell you why I was on Komodo. Writers, as I say, lead boring lives, stuck at home all day, raiding the fridge, having baths, making their Mac go bing. And having written two novels on the trot, which were becoming increasingly set in North London, because it was increasingly all I knew anything about, I decided it was time to do something different. So I spent a year with a zoologist friend of mine going around the world looking for various rare, endangered species of animal. Now, I sold the idea to my publishers, who were a bit nervous about me leaving the house, by saying that I was going to go around the world to look for various rare, endangered species animals and make jokes about them. And essentially, that was what I did. Now, I notice in Richard's introduction to the TED2 program, he raises the question about whether the E in TED2 should stand for education rather than entertainment. He makes the excellent point that if it's not entertaining, it's not going to communicate. One of the things I've always enjoyed about writing... hang on, what am I talking about? Nobody actually enjoys writing. You enjoy having written. One of the things I enjoy most about having written is taking a complicated or difficult idea and teasing the sense out of it so that in the end it becomes so simple that you laugh at it. If the idea is intact and actually expressed in the joke, then at the very moment somebody laughs at it, they see the point as well, but don't feel they've been lectured at. They're with you and enjoying themselves. Tell us some more, they say. One of my favorite ideas actually in Hitchhiker was that of the Babel fish. Which those of you who know the book will remember as being the fish that you stick in your ear and it translates different languages for you. But the reason the joke works, well, I think, and has any substance, is that I actually worked out... what people remember about the joke is that it's just funny you stick in fish in your ear. But why I think it works is I actually worked out very, very carefully how the thing would actually work and then reduced it down to a series of sort of interlocking jokes that actually made some kind of sense. So it had data integrity, if you like. And it was a fish, and fish are always funny. Ask John Cleese. So I thought it might be a good idea to put this principle to work in the service of something that I thought actually mattered. After a trip I made to Madagascar a few years ago, it had suddenly been brought home to me in a way that I understood and that meant something to me, that the world was bit by bit being destroyed around us. Everyone of any intelligence knows this and realizes that it's the major crisis now facing us. And indeed, we've just sat through an extraordinary hour of seeing this from the perspective of from outer space. But it takes something particular to bring that realization alive to any individual person, and people don't like being lectured to about it. It's a drag, as Paul McCartney said when he heard that John Lennon had been murdered. For me, it was Madagascar. And it was one person explaining to me perfectly, simply, how rainforest worked and why it was different from other types of forest that suddenly connected something with me. It was wonderfully simple, so simple that it was a real moment of pleasure to understand it. It was what Alan Kay calls the aha moment. So I wanted to write a book that would entertain people, make them laugh, and sort of sneak up on them with the serious stuff. Let them see what was going on in a way that actually meant something to people, because there's no point in preaching to the converted. I also wanted Apple to seed me with a portable Mac to write it on. Which they had promised to do, but that's another story. By the time I couldn't delay going any longer, the machine was still, as it turned out, a year away. So I took a Cambridge Z88 with me instead, and I made the very mysterious mistake of sitting on it when it was stuffed with notes. So one of the chapters in the book is therefore almost entirely fictional. But I won't say which one. So that's why I went, and that, to close one set of parentheses, is why I was on Komodo looking for dragons. Actually, of all the animals we went to look for, in fact, it's probably the least endangered. There are, in fact, 5,000 of them, which is a small population restricted to just three islands and therefore very vulnerable to any sudden changes in their habitat. But as far as anyone can see, that's actually as many as there have probably always been. And as far as people living on the islands are concerned, 5,000 of these buggers is quite enough to be getting on with, thank you very much. As I say, they seriously are man-eaters. I'll just tell you a little bit more about that, not because it has any particular relevance to anything else I want to talk about, but because it's nice and gruesome. I say they're man-eaters, but even if you just get bitten, you're in serious trouble, because when a dragon attacks a deer or a pig, it doesn't necessarily expect to kill it there and then. If it gets involved in a fight, it might get injured, and there's no benefit in that. So sometimes the dragon will just bite it and walk away. But the bacteria that live in the dragon's saliva are so virulent that the wounds will not heal, and the animal will usually die in a few days of septicemia, whereupon the dragon can eat it at leisure. Or another dragon can eat it if it happens to find it first. They're not really fussed. It's good for the species that there's a regular supply of badly injured and dying animals about the place. There was a well-known case of a Frenchman who was bitten by a dragon and eventually died in Paris 2 years later. The wound festered and would just never heal. Unfortunately, there are no dragons living in Paris at the time to take advantage of it, so the strategy broke down on that occasion, but generally it works well. Just in passing, I'll mention some of the other animals we went to look for before coming back to Indonesia, which is where I want to talk about an idea I've had about virtual reality, and thus bring this talk back within the bounds of what we're actually here to discuss. We also went to New Zealand to find the world's rarest, largest, fattest, and least able to fly parrot. Which is called the kakapo. There are only 42 of these left, and their chances of survival are very slim. Now, tell you a bit about natural history here. All the birds living on New Zealand are, to a greater or lesser extent, endangered, and some more than others. The kakapo is particularly endangered because up until a couple of hundred years ago, there were no predators at all on New Zealand. There were no mammals other than a couple of bats and stuff, but you don't worry about bats. There was nothing ever to run away from, particularly. And because flight is a survival mechanism, and it takes a lot of energy to fly, it meant that a lot of birds just decided, instead of having a quick snack and then flying off afterwards, they could settle down for a good meal and go for a waddle afterwards. Which was fine, it worked very well for them, until a man, of course, turns up with all sorts of dogs, goats, pigs, rats, cats, possums, and all these kinds of things. And these animals, who've never had to face predators before, are suddenly waddling for their lives. And the rarest of them is this extraordinary bird, which is called the kakapo. It is a sort of large, great, green, fat parrot. As I say, it's forgotten how to fly. It's also forgotten that it's forgotten how to fly. So a seriously worried kakapo will occasionally run up a tree and jump out of it. Whereupon it flies like a brick. But you see, by and large, the kakapo has never learnt to worry because there's nothing, been nothing for it to worry about because it's never, ever had to deal with predators before in its life. And because it's never had to deal with predators, and because, oddly enough, being eaten a lot is a good survival mechanism... What? Being eaten is actually quite a very, is a very, very good survival mechanism for a species because it stops the population getting too high. Because the moment the population, I don't know if anybody here sort of knows about sort of chaos graphs and so on, but if you have, if your rate of population goes up too fast, it suddenly hits a ceiling where the environment can no longer sustain that level of population, and it drops, and then it goes up again, then it drops, and if the rate is too fast, then it becomes completely chaotic, and that means if at some points the population is going to get so low that maybe it'll just take one tiny little thing and the whole lot will go. They'll all be wiped out. So they have to keep their population growing very, very slowly. And being eaten is a good way of arranging this. If you're not being eaten, as the kakapos were, then you have to find other ways of kind of shooting yourself in the foot. And the kakapo had developed the most extraordinarily bizarre and utterly ineffective mating rituals in order to ensure that its population never grew too much. I don't know where to begin on this. this is a very, very weird bird. It is thought by some people that the mating call of the kakapo actively repels the female kakapo. Well, it is the sort of it's the sort of behaviour you are. That's kind of biological absurdity you otherwise only find in discotheques. The bird makes the most. The bird finds itself a sort of remote mountain peak, builds a little sort of bowl in the earth, sits down, blows huge great air sacs out, and then booms through them. Now, this sound carries through the night. It's like the beginning of Dark Side of the Moon. It's this incredible whoom, whoom, whoom that just goes through the night. It's because it's very, very low frequency, it's there to sort of supposedly... because it's low frequency, you can't actually tell where it's coming from. So the idea is just to get the females excited, which apparently it doesn't. But not actually to tell them where the bird is. So there tends to be a lot of, I mean, if the booming noise is sort of come and get me, it's, well, where are you? Come and get me. Where are you? Come and get me. Where the hell are you? I mean, so they eventually manage to mate after a while, and the female lays one egg every 2 years, which usually gets eaten by a stoat. And the point is this, that because we've changed the way that New Zealand works, because we've just introduced something that wasn't there before, these birds, of which there used to be hundreds and hundreds of thousands, we're down to 42, and they are utterly extraordinary birds. They're extraordinary in their own way, as the dodo, which is the most famous extinct animal of all, and the dodo actually was an animal which played as important a role in our understanding of life on this planet as the Galapagos did. There's Galapagos. It's funny, we understand an awful lot about the way that life works from studying islands, because man's always had to work in the past by taking things apart to see how they work, how the bits interact. Islands have always been terribly, terribly important in our understanding of, or the development of our understanding on, of life on Earth. So the Galapagos Islands, where Darwin discovered that animals that had been separated from each other by just small stretches of water had started to diverge from each other. And that gave us the idea of evolution. And it was on Mauritius where this huge, great pink and grey dove, which is what a dodo was, was hunted to extinction just for the hell of bashing its brains out. But we suddenly realized for the first time that an animal could simply cease to exist and it would never, ever, ever be there again. It's as if we hadn't realized before that if you kill something, it's no longer there. It took something as dramatic, and because there had actually been extinctions before, obviously, but it was only because they were only known to exist within this one small island that once they were all gone, you knew there weren't any more. And this was a staggering idea, and was, as I say, it was as important to our understanding of the way that life develops on this planet as the Galapagos. We also went to China to look for the Yangtze River dolphin. The Yangtze River dolphin, there are about 200 of these left, and they live in a stretch of the water about 200, 300 kilometers long, upriver from Nanjing. The Yangtze River dolphin is almost blind. The reason for that is there's actually nothing to see in the Yangtze. Because the amount of mud in the water, the visibility is about that long. So gradually its eyes have just atrophied because there's been nothing for it to look at. And in fact, if you look at a dolphin fetus, and the interesting thing about fetus development is that it tends to be an action replay of the evolution of a species, you'll see that the eyes of the dolphin have gradually moved up the side of its head, trying to get any light that's coming at it from above. Because there's nothing to see, and they can't see, they work by echolocation instead, and they feed by echolocation, finding fish, and they communicate with whistles and so on. And this was fine up till a little while ago, but the Yangtze River now is actually a bit like the Ventura Freeway. And the incredible number of boats charging up and down the whole time, all of which have got diesel engines throbbing and throbbing and throbbing and churning up the water. It means that, it's rather like, we exist by sight. Sight is our primary source of information about the world. And if you're actually living in a discotheque, if you were deaf and living in a discotheque and just had lights and lasers and flares and so on going the whole time, you would actually be completely disoriented. And this is actually what's happening to the dolphins. So we eventually decided, actually, that we would try and record what it was like in the Yangtze River to see what these poor creatures had to deal with. And we were there with the BBC sound engineer, but because we'd only just thought of it while we were there, we discovered, of course, we didn't have an underwater microphone. And the BBC engineer said, well, there is actually a standard technique for waterproofing a microphone in an emergency. And we said, yes, what's that? And he said, well, you wrap it in a condom. I should say we were actually recording this for radio. And one of my sort of favorite moments of the whole thing was the day we spent in Shanghai trying to buy a packet of condoms. Not obviously speaking any Chinese ourselves, in the end having to sort of do it by sort of very, fairly graphic sign language. When we eventually got somebody to understand, they tried to give us contraceptive pills instead, and we sort of said, no, well, it's not gonna work with contraceptive pills. And trying to buy a packet of condoms and explain that it's because you want to record what the noise is that the dolphins have to listen to in the Yangtze River is actually one of the most absurd excuses ever. Anyway, closing another set of parentheses, there's another species I spotted on my travels, which is very, very endangered indeed. And this was pre-television man. I think that anybody who's here at this conference, a bunch of computer people essentially, actually, what is the collective noun for computer people?
Nerds.
No, a collective noun. I mean, like a few years ago, it probably would have been a batch of computer people. Or maybe a compilation of computer people. I think maybe today, in honor of Bill Atkinson, perhaps he should be a stack of computer people. Well, maybe a special one for Mac users. I would propose a chime of Mac users. Anyway, the fact that we're all here means that we are probably all agreed that television as a linear, non-interactive medium has been a mixed blessing, if I can put it no stronger than that. And I hope that one of the things we're here to do is plot its overthrow. So it's always with a sense of disappointment bordering on foreboding that you arrive on some small island in the Indian Ocean or at a village somewhere up the Amazon and discover they've recently acquired television and have now abandoned whatever else it was they were doing in favor of watching Dallas. There are places, of course, you can understand the problem. Let me digress a moment from whatever digression I was on and tell you about the Juan Fernandez Islands off the coast of Chile. This is a group of three small islands which have a very interesting history, because it was here in 1704 that a Scottish mariner called Alexander Selkirk was marooned for 4 years after having an argument with his captain, and he was stuck on this island in complete isolation for 4 years, and he managed to keep himself clothed in goat skins and fed with goat flesh by the simple expedient of learning to run faster than the goats. Eventually he was rescued 4 years later, taken back to England, and his story became very, very celebrated and formed the basis, the inspiration of the story of Robinson Crusoe. With the result that the island that Selkirk spent four miserable, isolated, castaway, lonely years on is now called Robinson Crusoe Island, and the village is called Daniel Defoe Village, which just goes to show that even if fact is stranger than fiction, fiction is what the public actually likes. Anyway, life... life for the villagers on these islands is so incredibly dull that a few years ago they imported to the island a particular species of frog, just because they liked the noise it made. It cheered things up in the evening. So that was their solution there. Then now they have satellite TV, of course, and they watch American cop shows. And that, of course, only increases the frustration of the young people living there. And I should explain, they're never ever, I mean, nobody there can ever possibly save enough money to move to the mainland. So the young people are now terribly frustrated because they would love to be able to crash cars and shoot people in Armani suits themselves. And they'll never be able to afford to do it, so they just live in a state of passive, brooding resentment brought them by television. So anyway, Indonesia. Wrapping up another set of parentheses. On our way to Komodo, we spent a couple of days in Bali, which David Attenborough and many other people have called the most beautiful place on earth. It isn't. It may have been, but it isn't anymore. If it is, I suggest it's now time to start seriously looking for another planet. I can well believe that it used to be, but it is now so crammed to the gills with tourists baying for beer and T-shirts and souvenirs of what it used to be like before they came there to bay for tea and beer and T-shirts and souvenirs of what it used to be like, that is now exactly the same as everywhere else that is crammed with tourists baying for beer and T-shirts and souvenirs of what they used to be like. So I have a modest proposal to make. I think it'd be a great idea if people could actually take their holidays in computers. Where are you going this year? Oh, the wife and I were thinking of taking the kids inside the Mac 5 for a couple of weeks. Tool down the new bus. Now, a lot of people are going to say that's an appalling idea. We should be getting out and seeing the real world instead of sitting inside fantasy machines and artificial realities. The trouble is, though, that we've been busy constructing artificial realities in the real world and bulldozing the real world to do it in. If we really want somewhere that's going to be full of gift shops and discos and souvenirs of what Bali used to be like, it seems a terrible shame to build it on Bali. Anyway, programmers amongst you will notice that there's one major set of parentheses I've left unclosed. I expect a sort of dialogue box to pop up saying, found left bracket without right bracket. And that is the Megapode. I have a well-deserved reputation for being something of a gadget freak, and I'm rarely happier than when spending an entire day programming my Mac to perform automatically a task that it would otherwise take me a good 10 seconds to do by hand. "10 seconds," I tell myself, "is 10 seconds. Time is valuable, and 10 seconds worth of it is well worth the investment of a day's happy activity working out a way of saving it." The Megapode on Komodo, Indonesia, has a very similar outlook to life. Now, it looks a little like a lean, sprightly chicken, though it has the advantage over chickens that it can fly, if a little heavily, and is therefore better able to escape from the dragons, which can only fly in fairy stories or in virtual realities. The important thing is that the Megapode has worked out a wonderful labor-saving device for itself. Now, the labor it wishes to save itself is the time-consuming activity of sitting on its nest all day incubating its eggs when it could be out and about doing things. And we came across one of its labor-saving devices as we were walking through the forest on Komodo. It's something that's quite hard to miss. It was a conical mound of thickly packed earth and rotting vegetation about 6 feet high, 6 feet wide at the base. In fact, it was probably considerably higher than it appeared because the mound would have been built on a hollow in the ground, which the Megapode would itself have dug out, and that would be about another 3 feet deep. Now, when I was writing the book about all this, I spent a happy hour writing a program in HyperCard that would tell me instantly what the volume of the mound was. This is a Megapode volume, a Megapode nest volume measuring stack. And it was a very neat and sexy program. Lots of pop-up menus and things. And the advantage of doing it the way I did it, of course, was that on any future occasion on which I need to know the volume of a Megapode nest, given its basic dimensions, my computer would be able to give me the answer in less than a second, which is a wonderful saving of time. The downside, I suppose, is that I cannot conceive of any future occasion that I'm likely to need to know the volume of a Megapode nest, but no matter, the volume of the mound was a little over 9 cubic yards, and in fact, I put all sorts of other bits and pieces in the stack, which will sort of tell you what the weight of it therefore would be, depending on the sort of vegetation, and I was wondering about putting in a little way of sort of working out what the temperature would get to and all that kind of thing, and other bits and pieces of information about the Megapode. As I say, I wasn't quite certain when I'd need it again, but the mound is an automatic incubator. Because the heat generated by the chemical reactions of the rotting vegetation keeps the eggs that are buried deep inside it warm. And not merely warm, by judicious additions or subtractions of material from the mound, the Megapode is able to keep it to the precise temperature which the eggs require in order to incubate properly. So all the Megapode has to do to incubate its eggs is merely to dig 3 cubic yards of earth out of the ground, fill it with 3 cubic yards of rotting vegetation, collect a further 6 cubic yards of vegetation, build it into a mound, and then continually monitor the heat it's producing and run about adding bits, taking bits away to keep the heat constant. And thus, it saves itself all the bother of sitting on its eggs all day. I like that in a bird. But the thing is, actually, ridiculous as the behaviour may seem, I mean, you do feel that the bird has actually done something and it's learnt something. And it's worked out something quite interesting. Because otherwise it would have just sat there all day or had baths or gone to the fridge. And it occurred to me that if I'd had my portable Macintosh with me, I would have been able to sit down and write this Megapode nest volume calculating HyperCard stack right there in the forest. But I didn't, so I had to do it later. And as I say, I will probably never ever again in the rest of my life have to measure such a volume. But maybe it's not entirely wasted, because I would love to think that if what we are all here to talk about today actually happens, that maybe one day in a few years' time, there would be somebody wandering around Komodo with a portable computer who happens to come across a megapode nest, opens up his computer, and says, "Tell me something about a megapode." The computer instantly searches the infinite virtual address space to which we will all then be connected, and we'll find my megapode nest volume calculating hypercard stack. And one will think that this displacement activity has actually, in the end, taught us all something and learnt something. And for me, I must say, having the Mac to play around with when I should be working is much, much better than lying around in the bath or raiding the fridge or sharpening my pencils or going and buying a new typewriter. Do you know, I once went to a typewriter shop in New York run by a guy called Martin Tytel, who I believe is quite famous in the typewriter world. And he customizes typewriters. And he told me that he always knows when one of his customers who's a writer has a new book to write, because he'll bring the typewriter in and says, "I'm tired of this font. Can you install another font in my typewriter?" Now, of course, it's much easier to do, and we do it all the time, particularly when we've got a book to write, and you put a new font in, and then the machine goes bing. As I say, despite the fact it's so easy to spend, I mean, I find as a writer, it's so easy to sort of spend your time doing all these sort of silly little things like building megapode nests. I learned an awful lot from doing that. I suddenly learned all sorts of stuff about sort of calculating geometric volumes that I didn't know before. And, hang on, I completely lost my train of thought. Ah, no, I hadn't written it down. That's why I've lost my train of thought. And so as a result of my using the Mac for the last 10 years, I can't tell you what an extraordinary stimulation, excitement, time-wasting, yes, I know, but very stimulating, exciting time-wasting. And I would like to say to everybody here who's had anything to do with the development of the Macintosh, thank you very, very much for an awful lot of pleasure. And that's all I'd like to say. Thank you very much.